Hey guys, welcome back to my channel. So today we are going to talk about measles virus. It is also called as a rubeola virus. Okay, so starting with the structure, how it looks, how many kind of components does it have, how will it invade the respiratory epithelium. So let's talk about that, because as we know, this is the virus we are talking about, the virology over here. So again, this virus will be actually affecting the respiratory tract of the human body, as other viruses also do. So look at the structure over here and let's appreciate how many kinds of things we are having in this virus. Okay, so first of all, this is enveloped virus. Okay, so this one is enveloped virus, right? It is having the envelope along with it, which you can see with the black color. Okay, this is the envelope over here. Okay, now it is having on the surface of this virus, on the envelope of this virus, we are having two main components over here which are present. That is the two main proteins which are present over here. One is hemagglutinin, okay, and the second one is F protein, which is fusion protein. Okay, F protein present on the surface of many kind of enveloped virus. For example, in the last video I talked about the respiratory syncytial virus, right, which was causing the bronchiolitis. In that also we also saw that we were having the F protein, fusion protein, on the surface of the virus, right? And here also there is two kinds of proteins, hemagglutinin and the fusion protein. Okay, hemagglutinin you saw on the surface of influenza virus, where we are having the hemagglutinin and neuraminidase HN, right? For an example, H1N1 virus, right? That is also a component of flu, right? Swine flu, influenza virus, right? But over here we are having two components. One is hemagglutinin, second is fusion. Okay, in the pathophysiology I will be talking about the significance of these components present on the envelope of this virus, because hemagglutinin will be helping this virus to attach to the respiratory epithelium, and this fusion protein will be helping this virus to invade the respiratory epithelium of the human body, right? So we are having these two proteins. Now moving further with the red color, you can see this is the matrix protein, right? This is the matrix protein. Then you are having the lipid membrane, right? So lipid membrane just beneath the envelope. Then you are having several kind of proteins which are the component of the nucleocapsid. For example, nucleoproteins are there, phosphoproteins are there, large proteins are there. Okay, so these proteins, but main thing over here is RNA, and over here we are having the single stranded, it is a negative sense, single stranded RNA, right? So what is that? It is a linear single stranded negative sense RNA. So if I will be talking about the morphology of this virus, this is actually first of all, this comes from the family of Paramyxoviridae, and it is a paramyxovirus, and it is an enveloped, as you can see, it is an enveloped virus with a helical capsid. Okay, it is having the helical capsid. It is having linear negative sense single stranded RNA virus. Okay, so that was about the structure of this virus. Okay, so let me summarize over here. So about this virus, what we can say, okay? So I am saying that this virus is actually an enveloped virus. It is actually having helical capsid. It is linear single stranded negative sense RNA virus, right? Okay, one more point about this, which family? Paramyxoviridae. So it is a paramyxovirus. Okay, it is a paramyxovirus. Okay, that is about the morphology of this virus. It is highly contagious, fine? So if you talk about the contagiousness, it is highly contagious. So which means, if one person is having this virus, and if that person is actually sneezing or coughing in public areas, so it can easily infect other kind of persons. It can actually infect 90% of the population which is actually immunocompromised, that kind of population which is actually not vaccinated against this virus, right? So it is highly contagious. Okay, and mainly it is affecting the children's, right? because obviously they are not having the properly developed immune system, right? So it is highly contagious. And how it is going to infect the persons? Via respiratory secretions, right? So I'm writing over here via respiratory droplets. Fine. Okay, so that was about the classification of this virus, morphology of this virus, and it is actually causing what? It actually causes measles virus. So I'm talking about the paramyxovirus, rubeola virus. So it is causing measles. So it causes actually measles. Okay, it causes measles. Fine. Now actually, what can be the risk factors? The persons who are actually having who actually do not have vaccination, okay? So the persons who are having lack of vaccination, so what can be the risk factor? Lack of vaccination. Fine. So if the person is not having the vaccination against this virus, it will be very easy for this virus to invade the respiratory epithelium of that person or respiratory tract of that person. Fine. Okay. Now, if you talk about the pathogenesis, right? If you talk about pathogenesis of this virus, so what you can think of, okay? Pathogenesis is very, very simple. Look, I told you when I was discussing the structure of this virus, of this measles virus, I told you that it is having heme agglutinin protein and the fusion protein on the surface of it, on the envelope, right? So, heme agglutinin protein, what will be happening? So let's say that this is the respiratory epithelium. Let's say that, yes, this is the respiratory epithelium. Okay, here is the respiratory epithelium, again another one adjacent to it, another one adjacent to it, another one. Okay, now let's say this virus comes. Okay, this virus actually comes, so I'm drawing it like this. Okay, and it is having what? It is having single-stranded RNA virus. Okay, very simple structure. Now, whenever it will be approaching the respiratory epithelium, okay, so what is that? This is actually what? Again, this is respiratory epithelium. Okay, so whenever this virus will be approaching the respiratory epithelium, it is having what I told you, structures along with that, right? So these structures are what? Let's say with the blue, which I am drawing over this virus, let's say these are the heme agglutinin protein. Okay, so with the blue color, they are heme agglutinin protein H, right? So they are actually H, and with the green color, okay, they are having fusion protein. So with the green color, they are actually F. Fine. So heme agglutinin protein will be helping this virus, measles virus, to actually bind to the surface of the respiratory epithelium, and fusion protein will be helping that this virus to actually invade. Okay, it will be facilitating the entry of this virus into the respiratory epithelium. So once it will be binding to it, okay, once it will be binding to it, and once the fusion protein will be facilitating the entry of this virus into the respiratory epithelium, this single-stranded RNA virus will be entering into the respiratory epithelium of this body, right? Now, again, this is actually negative sense, I told you already. So with the RNA, with the help of RNA polymerase enzyme, it will be actually converting itself into positive stranded RNA virus, okay? And then it will force the respiratory epithelium to make more and more copies of this virus, okay? And then it will be invading adjacent respiratory epithelium, so for example this one, and then it will be going to this one, okay? So adjacent respiratory epithelium, so it will be going to this one also. This is also positive stranded. Okay, so respiratory epithelium will be infected. Okay, now, so that was about the pathogenesis of this particular virus. Okay, now if you talk about the prevention, okay, how you can prevent this virus from infecting the persons, okay? Prevention is very easy. Get yourself vaccinated. Okay, so if you talk about the prevention, okay, That's why prevention is very important for the children. So we are having one vaccine, okay? And what is the name of that vaccine? That is the MMR vaccine. Okay, MMR vaccine is actually a trivalent vaccine. It is having the combination of the immunoglobulins against the three kinds of viruses, that is measles, mumps and rubella. Okay so two doses we are giving to the children. Okay, and what is that? Measles, mumps and rubella. So these are measles, is a combination of measles, mumps and rubella. Fine. Okay, now if you talk about the presentation part, how will you be identifying these patients? Presentation, that is very, very important. So if the patient will be coming to you, okay, how you are going to actually check over your patient? Okay, so first of all, what can be the symptoms, right? So symptoms will be high grade fever. Okay, so there will be a fever in the patient, high grade fever. High grade fever is not going to tell you about the proper diagnosis of this patient, because high grade fever is seen in many of the viruses, even in the bacteria, right? But the main thing over here is, which you can appreciate, that is about three particular things which will be helping in the diagnosis of this measles, may help you. Okay, so what is that? This is a triad of what? So this is actually a triad of three components, right? And what are these three components? Yes, they are actually 3C. okay, so I'm writing over here 3C. And what are these 3C? One is cough. First C is cough. Second is conjunctivitis, which means inflammation in the conjunctiva. Okay, redness of the sclera part, white part. Okay, and the third one is coryza, right? So these 3C are the particular finding of this triad, is actually the particular finding of presentation part of the measles. Okay, now, and along with that, there can be rash. Okay, along with that, there can be appearance of rash. Okay, so which kind of rash is, I'll be talking about that. So yes, so that these are about the symptoms of this patient. Okay, now if you talk about the physical examinations, for example, this was about the symptom. If you talk about the physical examination of these patients, so what you can appreciate, okay, in the physical examination, please remember very important point. Okay, that is actually coplic spots. Okay, what are they? Coplic spots. So what do you mean by coplic spots? Now, so let me show you an image over here. Okay, let me show you an image over here. But before that, let me tell you, let me summarize in front of you what is that coplic spots. They are actually having in the buccal mucosa, okay, near the premolars teeth, in the buccal mucosa, there is the appearance of bluish white macules. Okay, there is the appearance of bluish white macules. Okay, there is the appearance of bluish white macules, and with the background of bright red color. Okay, so with the background of bright red color. Okay, so let me show you an image over here now. So how you can appreciate these? For an example, this one. Okay, yeah, so look at this image over here. Okay, and there are the bluish whitish kind of macules you can see over here. Okay, these are the coplic spots. Okay, these are the coplic spots. For an example, this one I'm talking about. Okay, if I will be zooming over this, these are the premolars over here, and these white, which you can appreciate, these white. Okay, these are the white spots, and along with the bright red background, right? So what are they? They are the coplic spots, right? These are the coplic spots. Fine. Okay, so moving further now let me talk about, yes, another finding. They are actually maculopapular. So one is the coplic spot, okay, coplic spot, so that is the first one, okay, coplic spot, that was the first one, okay. And if you talk about the second one, that will be maculopapular rash, okay, maculopapular rash. So very particular finding, this is the second one, okay. So this is also very particular finding of the maculopapular rash, okay. And in this maculopapular rash, actually it starts in the head and neck region, okay. So it starts from where? It starts from head and neck, starts from head and neck, okay. And then it will be actually spreading towards the trunk region, okay, spreading towards trunk region, right? Very particular finding, okay. And it actually not present in palms and soles. Very particular finding, not present in palms and soles. So it excludes, please remember, palms and soles. Palms and soles, in those regions, there can be, if there are the rashes appearance, what it can be? Yes, it can be syphilis. For example, in the secondary syphilis, we are having the rashes on the palms and soles region. Okay, but in this video, I'm not talking about the syphilis. So forget about that. I'm talking about the maculopapular rash regarding the measles. So they are actually excluding the palms and soles. From where does it start? It starts from the head and neck region. From where it can spread? It can spread towards the trunk region, right? Okay, along with that, lymphadenopathy can be seen, may or may not be seen, right? Depend on the severity of the measles virus. Okay, now let's talk about the diagnosis part, fine? So if you talk about the diagnosis over here, okay, so let's talk about the diagnosis part over here now. Okay, so in the diagnosis, what you can see, first of all, there can be the finding of the immunoglobulins against the virus, okay? So no doubt about that. So there can be the finding of immunoglobulins. Which immunoglobulin? Measles specific. Okay, measles specific immunoglobulins can be seen. Measles specific immunoglobulin. Okay, if it is acute infection, recent infection, then it can be the appearance of immunoglobulin M. If it is chronic, then IgG. Okay, fine. What else we can use? PCR. Polymerase chain reaction. For most of the virus, we are using that. But the thing is, it is actually a bit expensive, okay, somewhat expensive. Then biopsy of lymph node can be done. Yes, biopsy of lymph nodes can be done if there is lymphadenopathy, let's say, right? And during the biopsy of lymph node, we are having a very, very, very particular finding that can be appreciated, actually. And that is actually Warthin-Finkeldy. Okay, Warthin-Finkeldy giant cells, bigger cells. Okay, Warthin-Finkeldy giant cells, in which lymphocytes are making a group and they're actually fusing with each other, and that's why we are having the appearance of a bigger cells over there. Okay, so they're actually made up of lymphocytes, fused lymphocytes. So these are the Warthin-Finkeldy giant cells, okay, where I'm talking about during the biopsy of the lymph node. Okay, that is the finding over there, right? Okay, now this was the diagnosis part. Now if you talk about the treatment part, okay, so you need to treat this patient. Now once you diagnose this patient, so in the treatment part, what you can do, okay, in the treatment, you can go for actually supportive treatment, okay? Most of the viruses is actually having supportive care or we are having what? Supportive care or antiviral agents, okay? In the supportive care, depends on the symptoms. For an example, these patients, hydration must be done, okay? So give IV fluids if there is dehydration, okay? Give antipyretics if the patient is having fever. Okay, what else? Give analgesics if the pain is persisting for a longer time, right? So symptomatic treatment is there. Along with that, it has been seen that vitamin A has been actually helpful in reducing the mortality. Vitamin A is actually helpful in reducing the mortality, in reducing mortality as well as morbidity, mortality as well as morbidity of the patient. Okay, if the patient is having good immunity, the actually symptoms start to subside by itself only within 1 week or two. Okay, if the patient is having not that properly developed immunity, because most of the time children are actually the target of this virus. Okay, because they are having the weaker immune system, right? Now along with that, we are having some complication. Okay, complications of regarding this virus, so let's talk about that as well. Okay, however it is rare, but it has been seen that it can actually can cross the BBB, that is the blood-brain barrier, and it can cause encephalitis in some of the children. Okay, however it is rare. So what I'm talking about, okay, I'm talking about the subacute sclerosing panencephalitis. Okay sometimes it has been seen. Now, and due to that, there can be the appearance of the convulsions, there can be the appearance of the seizures, right? So mainly it can be seen in the adulthood. For example, the person was having the measles during the infancy period, and now after 5 or 6 years it actually comes again and causing the encephalitis. Okay, and one more thing, for an example, we have been seeing about the varicella zoster virus. For example, the persons are having the chickenpox in childhood time, but they're having shingles caused by herpes zoster, right? Shingles in adulthood period, right? Same kind of thing is seen over here as well. Okay, so that was about the complication part. Okay, now let's move on to the MCQ section. Okay, one more thing, I was talking about the Warthin-Finkeldy giant cells, right? So right, Warthin-Finkeldy giant cells. So let me show you the structure as well, okay, of this virus, like how it looks. So about the Warthin-Finkeldy giant cells, okay, they looks like this structure over here, okay, which you can see in the screen, right? So yeah, so this is what, can you appreciate over here, lymphocytes are fusing with each other, right? So yeah, so this is the Warthin-Finkeldy giant cell. So this is actually the Warthin-Finkeldy giant cell, right? Warthin-Finkeldy giant cell. Okay, so that can be seen in the biopsy of the lymph node, right? Okay, now let's move on to the MCQ section. Okay, now let's talk about the MCQ section for one more thing during the presentation part. What about the maculopapular rashes? So maculopapular rashes are seen like this. Okay, maculopapular rashes are seen like this, you can appreciate in the image. Okay, so they are seen like this. So this is the measles maculopapular rash. You can see spreading on the first of all it comes in the face region, head and neck region, and then it spreads on the trunk region and then extremities. Okay, so this is the measles. What else can be the finding? Coplic spots, right? That will be present in the bluish white kind of discoloration in the background of red color, that can be seen in the buccal mucosa, right near the premolars. Okay, fine. Now let's move on to the MCQ section. So let's talk about this MCQ. A 2-year-old child presents with, okay, first of all, what is the age? 2-year-old child. Okay, most usually like it is infecting the child. Okay, but mainly pediatric age group are suffering from this virus. 2-year-old child presents to the pediatrician office for a rash. Okay, for a rash, his mother is against the vaccine. So this child was unvaccinated, that is the risk factor. right? So the child had not received any childhood vaccines. Her father, however, is worried about her lack of vaccination. So ask the doctor, this is measles or rubella? Okay, now measles is actually rubeola. Do not confuse it with the rubella. Okay, fine. So on physical exam, she has a high fever. Okay, high grade fever is seen in measles patient. Confluent macular papular rash, second finding. She also has blue white spots, third finding. Okay, so she was having the high fever, this child was having the confluent macular papular rash and blue white spots on her buccal mucosa. Now family is instructed to take isolation. Why isolation? Because it can actually infect the family members also. Most of the viruses are actually very, very contagious, and one of those is measles. Measles is very, very contagious. I told you during the discussion of this video, right? Now, isolation precautions have been instructed to the family from the physician side to bring in the child siblings who are also unvaccinated, and they are asking the family member that please bring those siblings also who are actually unvaccinated, because they are actually having also a risk of getting this measles virus. Right, so what can be the diagnosis of this patient? Yes, what is that? Yes, obviously that will be, so diagnosis will be over here, that is, yes. So what will be the diagnosis over here? Measles virus. Okay, measles or rubeola virus. Okay, let's talk about one more question over here. Okay, so yeah, so now a 12 year old boy is brought to the emergency room for cough. Okay, so now a 12 year old boy is brought to the emergency room for cough, high fever and rash. Now he also reports having itchy eyes for the past day, and the rash started on his head and neck and traveled downward towards his trunk. Okay, vaccination history is unknown. So major risk factor, during physical examination he has a confluent maculopapular rash that is blanching with pressure. Now there are blue white macules overlying a background of erythema on the buccal mucosa. He is immediately isolated, admitted to the hospital for supportive care and vitamin A supplementation. What is the diagnosis again? Very simple for you. That will be again, yes, that will be which virus? So diagnosis will be over here again, measles virus, right? Measles virus. Okay, so guys, that was about the measles virus or the rubeola virus. Okay, I hope you enjoyed the video. Please make sure to subscribe my channel. Please hit the like button and share with your friends. Thank you very much.